And we begin with this object up here, familiar to the entire human race ever since there has been a human race. That, of course, is the moon. And probably for hundreds of thousands of years, our ancestors have been looking up in the night sky long before there was such a thing as modern science, long before there were states, capitals, or any of the panoply of things we associate with civilization. This was an object of fascination to those who came before us. And for many people, this may well have been the thing that gave humanity its idea of the future, something that we have, but that animals don't really seem to have, the idea that there's another day coming, perhaps another week, another month, after years and years of observing the moon and knowing that there's going to be a full moon and a crescent moon and a gibbous moon and a half moon, the idea that there's something following today would have been a natural thing to conclude. So it could well be that a whole idea of future came from the moon and our observations of it. It's hard to tell, but that could well be where that idea, the very important idea, originated. Now, our ancestors, of course, always wondered about the moon, and they associated certain things about the human body to the direct influence of the moon. It was said for a long time in some cultures that if you were a female and you wanted to become pregnant, the way to get fertile was to lay in bed in a position where the moonlight would strike upon your body in just the right way. The menstrual cycle of women has long been associated with the moon. We have the expression moonstruck, the notion that maybe the moon has something to do with love and affection for other people. And of course, lunacy is an idea that directly comes from the moon. Maybe there's something about the influence of the moon that messes with our mind. And we all know that for a long time, this has been this idea that the full moon has an influence upon us so that crimes and other dastardly deeds may have become, over the course of years, more common in the full moon. So there's a spiritual, magical set of ideas associated with the moon that goes back a long way. The Greeks used to tell stories about the moon, like all cultures did, the most poetic one being that the moon, understood literally as Cynthia, was so in love with the mortal Endymion that she made Zeus make sure that much of the day was night so that Endymion would be asleep and she could come down and lay with him. And all stories, in all cultures, have a lot to do with the sky and especially the moon. So that is a history that goes back a long way. And if you look at it, you can see why people would tell stories about the moon. You can actually see certain shapes in the moon. And you can probably make this out. You see those two blotches to the upper right. They kind of look like rabbit ears. And many cultures have long seen a rabbit in the moon. The Japanese think about the moon as having a rabbit, pounding out the elixir of life, like an apothecary will pound out drugs. And it's often said among the Aztecs that the sun god put a rabbit in the moon to block out some of the moon's light so that the moon would never challenge the sun. The stories go on and on and on about this. But and sometimes during eclipses, the moon disappears. That's what that was about. So when we think about magic and we think about spiritual associations with the heavens, we're thinking about a tradition that goes back an awful long way. And in the 16th century, even the best minds in Europe were still occupied to some extent with what we would call magical thinking, at least to the extent that astrology was still very popular and almost universally subscribed to. No less a figure we saw last week than Tycho Brahe was spending much of his life making astrological forecasts because of the near universal belief, in Europe at least, that the stars in the moon had some influence upon us based upon where they were in the night sky, night after night. And this idea of magic and supernatural influences from the heavenly bodies took an awful long time dying. And they certainly weren't dead in the 16th and the early 17th centuries. But the story I want to tell today has to do with the way scientific knowledge is more remarkable and wondrous in its own way than any set of rules and myths and stories that have to do with magical thinking, at least as was understood in the late 16th and early 17th centuries. And of all the figures of the 16th century, the one who I think was most thoroughly, as a learned man, ensconced in the old magical supernatural tradition of understanding the heavens and the world around us was a man named Giordano Bruno. So just for a minute, let's leave the moon and we'll go to the hometown of Giordano Bruno. And here's the man himself. The way he was depicted in the 19th century based upon what we think might have been a 16th century rendering that's now lost. That's Giordano Bruno as a young man. And he was born in a little place, I think called Anola, in central to southern Italy, not too far from this city where he spent much of his young life, and that's Naples. There, dividing Naples, is the famous Bacchanapoli, which I think is still there. Of course it is, that's a photograph. And you can see the larger buildings of Naples in the background. But in Bruno's time, in the late 16th century, just as today, this is the great road that divides Naples, and you can see how crowded the city still is. Imagine the way it was in Giordano Bruno's time, when, as a young teenager, he went there to get a thorough education among the Dominican fathers. It was crowded, it was noisy, it was perhaps, according to some estimates, the largest city in all Europe in the 16th century, and it was a place with a great deal of intellectual ferment going on, especially among the church fathers with whom Giordano Bruno studied. And he soon learned just about all there was for them to be teaching him. He was a person of immense intellect. And he was not only interested in theology as he began to learn to become a priest, but it wasn't long before he became interested in almost everything else as well. And he began to wonder, he began to speculate, not just about the nature of church teachings, but the nature of the universe itself. When he finished his schooling here in Naples, of course, he became a priest, which is what he was trained to do. But he didn't do a whole lot of caring for souls. What he wanted to do and what he was driven to do eventually was try to get as close as he could to the mind of God. Now, how would you do that? How could you ever hope to do that? And among many other things, what Giordano Bruno became interested in studying as much as he could was the art of memory. How could you put yourself in a position where you would never forget anything? Maybe the way to be as close as you could to God was to train yourself so that everything you learned, everything you saw, everything you knew would always be there in your mind, not just to show up when you weren't expecting it, but to be summoned when you really wanted it. How, in other words, could you train yourself never to forget anything? Well, the ancient Greeks and the Romans had been very concerned with this topic. Paper was expensive, as was ink, and that was certainly true in the Middle Ages as well. You couldn't just write everything down that you needed to remember, especially if you were the average person. You had to train yourself to memory. And the art of memory training was a very established art in the Middle Ages, in the early Renaissance. What Giordano Bruno wanted to do was bring it to its highest level. How could you actually never forget anything? And he hit upon this method, which to us may seem a little bit strange, and that is what we think might be a fairly accurate rendering of Giordano Bruno's memory wheel. Now, the way the ancients often taught the art of memory was to imagine and to the extent that you could, memorize a great house, a great mansion with many rooms, with every room having a set of given identified objects in the room. And the way you would remember things is when you heard something or you read something, you would attach what you heard or what you read to certain items in certain rooms in the mansion. And the rooms might have closets, they might have wardrobes, and every single thing there would be matched up to an identifiable syllable or word or thing. So that if you had to remember a sentence or maybe a long series of sentences, what you would do in your mind is go back to that house that you'd already memorized and take a trip through the house so that every little sentence and every word would be something you could find in the house. And if you remembered how to get through the house from room to room, closet to closet, you could associate that with what you had to remember, and then it would always be in your mind. As long as the house was in your mind, so would what you read or so would what you heard. Well, Bruno thought you could do that better, and some people would argue with him about this, but this is what he did. He came up with what he called a memory wheel. Others were experimenting with similar techniques. He thought that this was the best way to go about it, though. And the memory wheel, as you see, has certain concentric circles. And there are probably in the real one, there are more circles than we have in this portrayal. But Bruno's idea was that if you could match up the outer circle, which would be a series of letters, A, B, C, D, E, to easily memorable figures in Greek mythology, let's say Apollo, then you could think of Apollo as the first letter or syllable and something you had to remember. And then the next letter or syllable could be something Apollo is associated with. The python, for example, which Apollo killed as part of the process that gave us the Oracle of Delphi. Well, so Apollo would be the first thing you had to remember. Then you always remember the python, because that's associated with Apollo. And the next thing you had to remember would be the python. And if you could associate whatever A, let's say, to Apollo, with another consonant letter or syllable, P, let's say, or maybe something else for python, then you could always remember that, and then you would associate that with the sentence or series of syllables that you had to remember. So if it's AP, something in your mind had to be AP, let's say. Well, that's Apollo Python. Now you tell the story of Apollo Python. Then you go on to maybe something Apollo might do with the Python. Could be any number of things. And then that would be the next thing that you had to remember, and you could associate that with the sentence or the page of the book or whatever it was you had to keep in mind. Now, what would you have to say about that method just hearing it summarized that way? Is that hard? Now, Giordano Bruno thought that would be really easy. Now, he mastered it. He was really good at it. And what he did was he began to go all over Europe, the German states. He went to England. He went to France. He met everybody in the intellectual life of Europe, even when he was still in his 20s and 30s. And what he wanted to do was impress upon them how easy this was. And he would sign himself on as a tutor to people, and he began teaching this stuff. And he was always very frustrated because they wouldn't get it. He was so frustrated. And they'd be angry with him, and he'd be angry with them because they weren't getting it. And you can imagine that eventually got fairly frustrated about all this. And he was not, for a long time, the most popular person among those who were angry at him for getting angry at them because they couldn't learn this as well as he did. But he was fired with enthusiasm for it, Giordano Bruno was. And we find him in the late 16th century believing more and more that this method would help you keep every possible thing you would ever need in your mind so that if you really mastered it properly, you would be close to God, who, after all, was a figure of infinite memory and infinite knowledge. And that's why he was so fired with enthusiasm for it. But the more he started thinking about infinity and the mind of God and perhaps the potential of human memory, the more he began to think that that idea of infinity, which could just mean not forgetting anything, and could just mean a way of thinking about God, is actually the way to understand everything. That infinity was a concept that isn't just the nature of the Godhead or the divinity, but actually characterizes all nature in the universe. And he began just by speculating, just by thinking, as he often did to himself, that maybe the universe did not, as the Greeks thought, and as Tycho thought, because nobody had the telescope yet, ended with the only stars that we could see. Maybe the universe goes on and on, beyond the visible stars. Maybe, in fact, Bruno thought, that infinity characterizing everything that we can perhaps understand, imagine, or know about God, maybe the stars go on and on and on to infinity. Maybe there are billions of stars. Maybe there are trillions of stars. And he also began to think that around all those stars, there could be planets just like Earth rotating, although he didn't know about rotation in the way that he could prove it, at least being close to those stars. And perhaps there were many systems, much like what we call the solar system. So this is what he said. He said, this entire globe, this star, may not be unique. It may be one of an infinitude of stars and planets and orbs stretching out beyond the imagination. And the more he thought about infinity in the macro sense, the more he began to think of it in the micro sense as well. Long before he knew what a microscope was, he began to believe that some of the Greeks, like Democritus, had been right when they said that everything is simply composed of tiny micro particles that we can't see. The Greeks called them atoms, and Bruno began to think that's probably right. Everything is just atoms. And there's an infinite number of these atoms, and we're all composed of them. And every single thing in the universe and every single thing that we see is simply composed of these little things. And he also said, very strikingly, that if that's true, if we are all just arrangements of atoms, it makes no sense to say that anything ever passes away. That if you take seriously infinity as a concept, it must mean that we may die, but the atoms in our body can't die. They go on. They're only transformed into different atoms and different arrangements. And what he said was, we are not subject to death or dissolution. Annihilation is impossible anywhere in nature. From time to time, everything renews itself by altering its parts. Everywhere there is relative change in the observer. We are always at the center of everything. We are always not at the center. We are always at the center. It's all relative. In a universe composed of planets and stars and atoms to an infinite number. And if that's true, what Giordano Bruno had just discovered by sheer speculation and taking the idea of infinity seriously was what physicists would come to call the law of conservation of mass, that nothing ever is destroyed. Once mass is there, it's not destroyed, at least in a closed system, which would lead us also, because mass is convertible to energy, to the law of conservation of energy, vital concepts of modern physics, not really understood until the late 19th and 20th centuries. And he had given us that. He had given us that all the way back in the 16th century. This is a monumentally impressive thinker, a figure of towering intellect. But the more he began to think about that, the more people are going to take notice of him, not just as a tutor who didn't seem to be the best teacher you can imagine, but also as somebody who was preaching very powerful and maybe dangerous ideas, because the church, the Catholic Church, of which, of course, Giordano Bruno was a member, was not going to look with much approval on this, and there's a good reason for that. If you take seriously the idea that everything is just atoms and everything is just different arrangements of atoms, what happens to the precious and vital church doctrine of transubstantiation? What happens to the idea that during the communion mass, the wine and the wafer, the bread, are actually transformed into the actual blood and the body of Christ? What Bruno was saying, everything underneath is just atoms. But what the church was saying, no, there's a qualitative transformation of great power that occurs in the mass. The body is the bread, and the blood is the wine. And Bruno was saying, no, they're all atoms. Everything is just atoms. So this seemed to question transubstantiation. And at the same time, he was saying things even more dangerous. He was saying that if there are billions of planets and billions of other worlds, then perhaps the incarnation of God in Christ is not unique. Perhaps there are other gods. Perhaps there are other incidences of divine supervision over other peoples. And he began to deny the virgin birth. He didn't find a place in the speculation of his idea for the virgin birth. And he began to say that. And the more he began to say that, the more he began to get in trouble. So he was preaching a doctrine of physics that seemed to call transubstantiation into question. And then he actually began to deny the unique incarnation of God in Christ. Now, once he said that, the church arrested him. Now, he was in Venice, and he was trying to teach somebody his memory theory in Venice. And he happened to be a nobleman who was learning at the foot of Giordano Bruno, and he wasn't learning very well, and he got to be frustrated with Giordano Bruno, and this guy turned him in to the Roman Inquisition, as it turned out. And so now we find Giordano Bruno in Rome, and there he was put in a cell that's about 6 foot square, and the cell was beastly hot during the summer and very, very cold during the winter, and there he stayed for 8 years. In that cell, six foot by six foot for 8 years, nothing but straw to lay on, he would periodically be brought out for questioning. And he was told that he had to recant these beliefs, which were heretical according to official church doctrine. Keep in mind that the church at this time in the late 16th century was under siege and felt itself very much under threat from the Protestant Reformation. And it was going to take very seriously challenges to its doctrine like those seemingly presented by its own son, Giordano Bruno. Now, when he wouldn't recant, we know that he was tortured. We don't know exactly how. The records aren't as detailed as we'd like. But we do know that he probably was tortured according to the rules of the Inquisition. And one rule was that whatever torture you're going to adopt, you can't make the subject bleed. Because if they bleed, if they start bleeding, they might be reminded of the sufferings of Christ and therefore take heart. So any torture was not going to let you bleed. And the other thing was they couldn't repeat the torture. They went in a series of stages, beginning with the water torture and eventually ending up with something called the stivaletto, which is too nasty to describe. But they would go stage by stage by stage by stage. And they couldn't repeat the same torture twice. Now, the rule there was that if one torture wasn't working and then you had to stop for a while, you would adopt the idea, or at least the convenient myth, that you weren't really stopping the torture, you're only pausing it. And then you go on to the same torture as if it's a continuation by calling it a pause and not a stoppage. And so then you could keep going doing what you're doing. Now, the various tortures to which he was subjected are well known in the records as far as general Inquisition practices, but we don't know exactly what happened to him. We think he probably was put on the rack, but that's about all that we think we know. But we do know that he never recanted. He never recanted what he believed. He was told, you've got to deny this belief, and he would never do it. And so finally, after 8 years, they decided there was no help for it, and he had to be executed. So what they decided to do, and this is February 17th, 1600, the very dawn of the 17th century, was bring him out and take him to the Campo di Fiori in Rome, where the wood had been all prepared for him. And as he emerged from the prison, I think probably seeing the sunlight for the first time in 8 years, one can only imagine his emotions and imagine what he did. There it was. There's the sun. There's the heavens again. As he was in his prison cell, I often imagined him going back through his mind with this memory technique that he'd mastered, probably reading every book again that he'd ever read, just going back through his mind keeping himself company that way. But now at last he'd see again the sun. He probably looked at it or tried to, and then he could hear the voices of hundreds of people along the road, jeering at him, shouting at him, calling insults at him, uttering vulgarities at him. And he wanted to talk back to them. He wanted to try to answer what they were saying, but he couldn't, because to prevent that, what the authorities had done was take an iron spike and put it right through his cheeks so he couldn't talk. And then they took him to the stake, and then they tied him to the stake, and they wanted to make sure that he wasn't going to pass out from smoke, as many people did. So they had the wood nice and dry, and then they lit the fire, and he passed away in the Campo di Fiori, February 17th, 1600. But what happened, as we know, because we live in the 21st century, is that when the flames had devoured him, and when the authorities pounded out what remained of his bones so that nobody could take them as a souvenir, the embers and the tiny little bits of bone and flesh that had been Giordano Bruno were washed away by the rains, and they went into the Tiber, and they were eaten by the fish, and some of it was blown away into the plains surrounding Rome, where it found itself in the fields, where animals and perhaps eventually people could devour them, getting into fish and people and other animals. He was right. No mess is ever destroyed. It all continues. And some of us may be part of Giordano Bruno to this very day, based upon simple statistics. It's probably likely that there's a bit of Giordano Bruno in all of us. He was right about that, although he wouldn't live to see the day when we would know he was right about that. Now, there's a reason I bring up Giordano Bruno, because at the time he was suffering at the stake, at the beginning of the 17th century, this man was very active not too far down the road, and I think by then Padua, in the Venetian Republic, about 20, 25 miles from Venice. And that, of course, is Galileo. So I propose now to talk about Galileo and perhaps see him in relation to Giordano Bruno, because Galileo was a very different sort of person. Here's somebody who is not, to me, part of the great magical tradition from which Giordano Bruno emerged, from a tradition from which he began to have ideas, physical ideas, that we would associate with modern science, like the law of conservation of mass. Galileo, however, is a very important transition figure, because his ideas did not come from spiritual speculations. His ideas came from good, solid experimentation. And that's what makes him, for many people, the first of the great modern scientists. And here he is. Well, we know where he was from. He was an Italian, born in Pisa, not too far from Florence, at a time when Pisa was not such a nice place to be. Like Naples, very crowded streets, great deal of disease, mostly because there was a lot of wetlands around Pisa where mosquitoes flourished. And long before anybody knew that mosquitoes caused malaria, what they would need to do to try to fend off that dread disease was burn smudge pots in the street, which would try to make the air a bit purer, air a bit cleaner, but which really made everything smell bad. And according to all the other things that were there to smell bad, it would make Pisa and Naples and these other Italian cities not pleasant places to be. Luckily, eventually, the Medici drained those swamps, and that, as a matter of fact, took care of the malaria problem to some extent. But when Galileo was there, this is still a pretty unhealthy and very crowded place to be. Now, he was the son of Vincenzo Galilei, who was a musician and sometimes wool trader, and also the son of Giulia Galilei, Vincenzo's wife, who was always after Vincenzo to make more money and make more of himself. And Galileo never lost this habit for the rest of his life, always wanting a bit more fame, always wanting a bit more money, and never quite secure with what he had. And there was always a part of him, no matter how hard he was working on something and experimenting with something, that was worried about next month's pay. And that's one reason why he would go from job to job, always when he thought he saw a better, more glittering opportunity. Now, he had very good schooling in Pisa and also Florence, where the family moved when he was a young man. And he became interested, among other things, in joining the church. But that was not going to work out, because his eyesight was exceptionally bad, especially when he was young. And he was not going to be able to do all the reading that he really wanted to do. And as a consequence, he became interested in math. And he became a first-class mathematician when he was only a late teenager. And his first jobs were as a math teacher. But in terms of math and science, these, he would be pleased to know, would fire his imagination a lot more than theology ever did, even in his younger days. And so we now turn to him as a very young instructor at Pisa, earning a living, teaching students math as best he could, with an eyesight that would sometimes be OK, sometimes not so good, and would vary with the years. Now, while he was teaching at Pisa, he became interested, as almost everybody was who was in the sciences, in the ideas of Aristotle. He knew Aristotle like almost everybody else did, if they were interested in the sciences. But one thing about Aristotle that really bothered him was Aristotle's idea that objects heavier in mass will accelerate and fall at a faster rate than objects lighter in mass. And there was something about mass, and there was something about that that really bothered Galileo, because as he told his students, wait a minute, it seems correct, it seems common sense, that something heavier in mass will fall at a faster rate than something lighter. But have you ever looked at hailstones? When hailstones come down from the sky, from way, way up there, they seem to fall at pretty much the same time. A lot of them fall at once. But we know that some hailstones are much heavier than other hailstones. Does that mean that the heavy hailstones are somehow from way, way up clouds, and the light hailstones are from lower clouds, and yet somehow they come up and they hit the same time? Are they so precisely calibrated that you got the higher hailstones coming down right when the lighter hailstones from the lower direction in the sky come down and hit the ground at once? How can that be? That seems like a big coincidence. So he began to doubt this, and he began to feel that maybe they fall at similar or identical rates, and he may or may not have actually tried this out on the Leaning Tower of Pisa. To this day, we don't really know if he stood up there on the Leaning Tower of Pisa and dropped two items of different masses to see if they would hit the ground at about the same time. He might have, he might not have, but he certainly thought that probably Aristotle was wrong about this. He became very interested in motion, and he began to conduct some very good and very provocative experiments in motion as a young man. And he was occupied in that, producing manuscripts about motion and the way things moved, and he began to use that to overthrow everything Aristotle had ever said about motion, an idea I'll get to in a little while. But how do we really know Galileo? What is he most famous for? Yes, so now let's turn to what he did that would soon get him in some trouble with the same authorities that would condemn Giordano Bruno. It so happened that in the first decade of the 17th century, when Galileo was just becoming famous for his ideas about motion, that this man, Hans Lippershey, was experimenting with a device in the Netherlands that would allow you to see things magnified at great distances. Now, there's a pretty good reason why he was doing that. And you can see in this commemorative medal what he was thinking. If you had some sort of glass that you could hold that would allow you to see something at a distance that you couldn't see with the naked eye, that would be very good for military purposes, especially if you were the Netherlands, occupied as you were with decades of very, very serious and very bloody wars with the Spanish. You would want to see if there were Spanish ships on the horizon so you'd have time to prepare for them. Now, Lippershey was somebody, like many people in the Netherlands, who had been experimenting with lenses and how to make eyeglasses better. And it occurred to him that if you took concave and convex lenses, and if you arrange them in just the right way in some sort of tube, you could look through the tube and you could see things magnified at greater distances. He fiddled around with it for a little while, and he finally came up with this, although for some reason it's invisible in the metal, what some people think might be the first working telescope. And he introduced it to the authorities in Amsterdam. They were very impressed. They bought it from him, and he began to build more of them. He had a patent on them. And he sent one of his employees to Italy to see if this thing could be sold to anybody else. And this employee showed up in Padua in 1608, just when Galileo was earning a very good living in the same place teaching math and science at the University of Padua, under the authority of the Republic of Venice. Well, Galileo heard about this thing, and immediately something clicked, because remember, this was a guy who was not at all indifferent to the claims of money and fame. What if he could make a better telescope? If this employee of Lippershey was going to sell the telescope in Venice, they might get a prior right to it, and that might be the person making the money. But Galileo wanted to sell this thing to the Doge of Venice, going right to the Venetian state, because nobody, you would think, would want a telescope more than Venice, a place always concerned about pirates, and a place always concerned with hostile fleets approaching the Great Lagoon. And if they could see pirates in any kind of threat with this thing, then that would be a big advantage to them. So Galileo went to the Doge of Venice in the Great Council of Ten, and they had a big meeting to let Galileo display and to test what he now claimed to be his telescope. In fact, it was. He spent 24 hours perfecting the telescope after just barely knowing what it was and getting his hands on one. Within a day, he made a much better one with the help of some lens crafters that he knew. And he took that telescope to the Doge, and he let the Doge look through it, and sure enough, looking in the direction of the entry to the lagoon of Venice, they could see galleys approaching that wouldn't be visible to the naked eye for at least 2 hours. And they couldn't believe it. There's those galleys approaching the lagoon. And then he took it and he pointed in that direction, and they could see the great church towers of Padua, 25 miles away. The Council of Ten and the Doge were astonished by this. This is absolutely spectacular. And you would think the next thing Galileo would do is say, well, you want to buy it. But what's the smart thing to do if you're Galileo? And he was a pretty smart guy. You don't want to sell this to the Doge. You want to say, I'm glad you like it. Here, you can have the telescope. Galileo can make hundreds of these if he wanted to. Here, you can have the telescope. And the Doge was so taken with gratitude that he told Galileo, I'm going to double your salary at the University of Padua, and I'm going to give you a lifetime appointment, lifetime tenure for handing over the telescope free. See, you give it to him free, you're going to get a lot more than if you sell it. Now you got a whole life at Padua where you can teach all you want to. Problem with Galileo was he's never satisfied with these jobs. What he really wanted to do was go work for the Grand Duke of Tuscany, the Medici's in Florence. But at least now he's got a better job until he can get that job of the Grand Duke that he really wants. So now that he'd done that, he had this telescope, he began working on making them better. And the next year he made about 100 telescopes. 90 of them he wasn't satisfied with, 10 of which though worked really well. And within a couple years, he got that wonderful job with the Grand Duke of Florence. And now he took the telescope, now much better than the one he'd given to the Doge, and he began looking up very carefully into the sky. And we all know what he saw. And the first thing you're going to look at in the sky, probably, is the moon. We don't think he was the first one to look at it with a telescope. They had it in the Netherlands. But he began carefully recording what he saw. And this proved, as if anybody were in any doubt, that the moon could not be the perfect quintessence-made thing that the Greeks thought it was. The moon, in fact, was much more complicated than this smooth, silvery orb, poetically, that the ancients had imagined. There were craters in the moon, and there were mountains in the moon, and these are the drawings Galileo made. And all you had to do was record carefully the extent of the shadows you could see with a telescope, and you would have a pretty good idea how tall the mountains were on the moon, which Galileo now recorded in his journal. So now he looked at the moon, and he saw this. And then what he did, not unexpectedly, was he began to look at the stars. And he pointed the telescope at what anybody back then could see very easily in an age before electricity, the great Milky Way. He pointed the telescope at the Milky Way, and he saw not just clouds, not just some strange, undefined, and inexplicable series of feathery beauty in the sky. What he saw instead were stars. The Milky Way was made of stars, far more stars than anybody had ever seen with the naked eye. So Giordano Bruno was right about that, 12 years too late. And then he took the telescope and he looked up at the constellations, looked at Orion. He saw the three stars, the famous three stars of Orion's belt, and he saw that they weren't three stars. There were dozens of stars in Orion's belt that nobody had ever seen before. And he was taken with astonishment at this. And every time he pointed the telescope at something, he saw something new. He pointed the telescope finally at Saturn, the farthest planet we can see with the naked eye. And he saw something he couldn't explain. Saturn bulged. There were these, like, ears. Saturn had ears. And sometimes the ears would look a little bit different. And he couldn't explain that. What's happening to them? And he said, is Saturn devouring his children again? Because the ears would disappear. Sometimes they get bulbous. Sometimes they go like that. Well, of course, those were rings, and he wouldn't know that. We wouldn't know that for a long time. But that needed explaining. The more he pointed the telescope at anything, the more new explaining had to be done, which is the beauty of all this. Once you know you don't know something, you actually begin to figure out how to know something that really is valuable. And then, almost as momentous as anything else, he points the telescope at Jupiter. And then he saw these strange stars he'd never seen before. Stars around Jupiter, okay. But the next night, he pointed at Jupiter again, and the stars had moved, not like stars usually move, much more quickly. And the next night, they were in a different place, and the next night, at a different place. Well, what's going on? And what he'd seen were what we still call the Medician moons, or the Galilean moons, after him. Galileo, always wanting to curry favor with those in power, named them the Medician moons or the Medician satellites. First, he called them the Medician stars. But we know that they're not stars, and Galileo knew that too. They were moons. They were Io, Ganymede, Callisto, and Europa, the four great first moons that we saw of Jupiter. Now, what would it mean that there were moons orbiting Jupiter. It had to mean that here's further proof that the Earth is orbiting the Sun, the Earth with its own moon orbiting the Sun, the Jupiter with its moons orbiting the Sun. It all made sense in all of a piece. They came to be called satellites, very appropriately, because that's the old word that was used for courtiers who were always surrounding somebody in power and flattering them. Satellites to a courier, satellite to a king, satellite to a planet like Jupiter. And the more he looked around, the more he saw wonders like this. And he published these results. And at first, he had a lot of friends in Rome, even among those in the Vatican, who were impressed by this, encouraged him to keep going. And among those friends was a sort of an amateur astronomer who became a very good one later on, among the Jesuits, who urged him to look at Venus. Because if you looked at Venus, and if Venus had phases, like the moon does, wouldn't that mean that the Earth is here, Venus is here, and the Sun is there? And if Venus looks like it has phases from Earth, that must mean we're all moving around the Sun. Look at Venus. Now, Galileo may have had the same idea, but he took them up on the offer, and he saw that indeed Venus has phases observed from the Earth. So Earth, Venus, they've both got to be moving around the Sun. So this is really the point where we proved to the satisfaction of anybody with an open mind that Earth had to be moving around the Sun. There's no other way to explain that. Earth, Venus has phases, we're all moving around the Sun. Now, he published everything that he learned in one of the great books of science called The Starry Messenger. And it suggested very strongly that the Copernican theory was true. We're all going around the Sun. But the problem with saying that and preaching that as the truth, which is what Galileo thought it was that it did run contrary to the official teachings of the church. And so after he published The Starry Messenger, Galileo was called to Rome, and Cardinal Bellarmine, very, very brilliant cardinal who was working in enforcing church teachings, questioned him about this, informed him or reminded him that the Copernican theory was condemned by the church. After all, in the Old Testament, God had made the sun stand still. Why would he be making the sun stand still if the sun wasn't moving around us? And Galileo was told, you've got to stop preaching this as the truth, as you've been doing by publishing books like The Starry Messenger. Now, what Galileo was actually told has long been a center of some controversy, but the best that we can reconstruct, based upon the Vatican records, are the following words, and I think I can find them exactly. Pope Paul V, having set Bellarmine towards examining Galileo like this, finally produced an official document, and the document said, that Galileo was not to teach, defend, or discuss the Copernican theory. You can't teach, defend, or discuss the Copernican theory. And as of February 1616, that was the official Vatican document. And in association with that, the church reaffirmed its faith in the old Ptolemaic system, contrary to Copernicus, by saying, quote, since the false doctrine of the movement of the church taught by Nicholas Copernicus is altogether contrary to scripture, and is spread about and received by many persons to the detriment of the Catholic faith, the congregation has decreed the works of Copernicus to be suspended until they can be corrected. So you can't teach, defend, or hold the Copernican theory. So Galileo went back to teaching, went back to doing what he was doing. But the controversy is, a few weeks later, he got a letter from Cardinal Bellarmine, who had been his main examiner, and Bellarmine had reminded him that you can't defend or hold the Galilean theory. You can't defend or hold the Galilean theory. But he left out the word teach. And that presents a controversy. Now eventually, years go by, and we don't have to get into the details, but what happened, as we all know, is that Galileo got in trouble again with the church because he took it into his head, on the advice of his friends, to do his best to actually present all the existing theories of the way the planets moved. He was sure Copernicus had been right, and we know he was right to be sure about that, but he wanted to express that theory in relation to the other theories, and so he did that through the device, the old Greek and Roman device of a dialogue. And it became the scientific sensation of the time, called Dialogue of the Two World Systems. And he made a big mistake when he labeled the defender of the old Ptolemaic system. Anybody remember what he called him?
Simplicio.
Called him Simplicio. as in simple-minded. And the guy who was defending the Copernican theory was a well-known intellectual everybody knew was smart. Sagredi, I think. Yeah. So Simplicio is saying Ptolemy's right, and the smart guy saying Copernicus is right. So it was clear what side Galileo was on, and when he published this, the man who is now Pope, an old friend of Galileo, named Barberino, took very, very, very strong offense, believing that Galileo was now doing what he wasn't supposed to do, teaching the Copernican system by making Sagredi look right and Simplicio look as he was simple. And this time, Galileo was brought back to Rome, and this time he was officially examined for heresy, having apparently taught the Copernican theory by putting it into the mouth of the smart guy in Dialogue of the Two World Systems. And this time we think, although the records are not as detailed as we'd like, that he was at least shown the rack, at least shown the rack, which would be the torture to which he might be subjected to. By now he was 70 years old, and to be shown the rack must have been a terrifying thing indeed. We don't think he was literally tortured, but he was at least shown the instruments of torture, and he did recant, and he apologized for his error in teaching something contrary to church doctrines, and he promised never to do it again. And as his punishment, he was now put famously under house arrest, where he would spend the rest of his life, 9 years. He would die in 1642, just a few months before Isaac Newton was born. Galileo died, Newton was born in the same month, same year. But what I wanted to bring up was what he did when he was under house arrest. He began to think back to his early teaching days in Pisa, when he apparently was thinking not just strongly about Aristotle's errors about how things moved, but also experimentally. Maybe he did drop those items of different mass from the Tower of Pisa, but we'll never know. Now, the problem with that experiment was that if you're going to drop something from a height, especially something as tall as the Tower of Pisa, it's really hard to measure how fast things are going. You can see that they hit the ground maybe at the same time or close to the same time. But he wanted to know more about motion. And how could you devise an experiment that would actually demonstrate how things are actually moving? And specifically, what he wanted to do was question a theory of Aristotle that he was pretty positive had to be wrong. And that is that the natural state of everything is at rest. So that if you have, let's say, a ball or anything with mass, if you push it, according to Aristotle, it'll go only as far as the momentum of the push, and then it'll stop. Because what things want to do, according to Aristotle, is be as close as they can to the center of the Earth. So that you can push something, you can throw something, but they will always go towards the center of the Earth once the momentum, the impact of your throw or your push has been spent. Things want or naturally are at rest. Well, Galileo wondered about that. How could you test that? And what I propose to do, probably unsuccessfully, is to show you how he proposed to test that. Now, he wanted to do that under house arrest. It's not as if he can have a lot of freedom about this, but there is something you could do to test how things move. And what he began to do was build these planes, like you see here with these books. So we can start out with History of the World in 1,000 Objects. So let's put it like this, and we'll assume that it's not going to move, although we know that things always move, but let's assume that's not going to move. So what he began to do was simply roll balls down these inclined planes, one of the most famous experiments in the history of science. And the nice thing about that is, in his quarters under house arrest, he could actually measure how fast the things were going down the plane. How he did that is a matter of some dispute. Some people think he had a little pendulum going back and forth, and he was very good at pendulums, knew all about them, so that he could measure how much time was passing as the ball was moving past certain fixed points on the inclined plane based upon the movement of the pendulum. Other people think that that he didn't have anything to do with pendulums and that he had little bells all along the plane. So if something hits the bell, it'd make a little ring, then it's going faster, makes another bell. You can measure the interval between the bells as the ball was going down the plane. But what he probably did, based upon our best evidence, was he had a water clock. So the water clock was dripping at a constant rate like water clocks do, and he would just measure out the extent of water based upon the drips, and then he'd know based upon specific places along the plane when the ball got there, based upon the drips coming off of the water clock, and that's probably how he measured it. But however he did it, what he found was this, and this is astonishing. If the ball goes down the plane, Galileo saw, the ball would accelerate, it would pick up speed as it goes down the plane. There doesn't seem to be any surprise there. But how do we measure it? Well, what he found was this, that if you take certain units of distance, let's say 1, 2, 3, certain equal units of distance down the plane, that the ball was accelerating at a constant mathematically fixed rate. So that, let's say 1 second, it goes 1 unit. And then he saw that after 2 seconds, it's actually gone a distance of unit of 4. And then after 3 seconds, it's gone 4 plus 5. So instead of going 1 unit where it begins, now it's going 5 in that other constant frame of reference, which means the ball is speeding up. But look how it's speeding up. 1, then the next unit is 1 plus 3, so 1, 3. Then the next unit is 4 plus 5, 1, 3, 5. So what do we have there? What we have there, according to Galileo, is a mathematical law about how mass accelerates. And it accelerates according to the mathematical law, time squared equals distance, right? Distance equals time squared. Oh, isn't that amazing? Anything with mass accelerates according to that rate. But the really amazing thing is what you can make of that. Now here, let's try to add something to our inclined planes. So we're going accelerating down this plane as we put a ball here at the beginning, 1 unit, 2 seconds, now we got a total of 4 units, 3 seconds, now we've got a total of 4 plus 5, 9 units. Okay, that's pretty interesting. But now what happens? Let's put another inclined plane like this. Let's put it at the same angle, same angle. Ball goes down. How far up the other inclined plane is it going to go up? Almost the same. That's the really key thing, almost the same. It's always going to go down, then it goes up, but it's never going to quite get the length of the original inclined plane. Now think about that. For me, if I'd learned that, if I were Galileo, I wouldn't make anything of it. But he was smart. So he figured, wait a minute. So why doesn't it go up to the equal point on the other inclined plane? Why doesn't it? Friction. Friction of the books, in my case. Galileo had better apparati, which might be the plural of apparatus, or it might not. But so friction stops it from going up the opposite plane to the same extent where it started on the original plane. Now what happens if we change the angle? So this one here, it's a little bit lower angle than this one where the ball originally rolled down. It's going to go down this, and it's going to go up this. And the distance that goes up the lower angle is going to be more than that distance. So let's put those two facts together. Friction stops it on equal planes from going up to the same point. But on a lower plane, obviously there's still going to be friction, but it's going to keep going a bit further because the angle is lower. Now put those things together, and what do we know will happen if the ball goes down this, gets to a level point, but there's no friction on the level point? What will the ball do? It'll keep going until the rest of time. And that single insight revolutionized physics. That's how we get rocketry, space travel, or as Galileo would eventually phrase it, although I don't think he used it as exactly as Newton did eventually. Now what we have is the law of inertia, that any object with mass will always keep moving as long as it doesn't confront an unbalanced force stronger than it that will bring it to rest. But everything will always keep going. Anything with mass will always move once it starts until it confronts something that disrupts the balance as a stronger force and will bring it to rest. The natural state of anything moving is moving, just stay in motion. Because he had reasoned that if friction slows down the ball and makes it eventually come to a halt before where it would usually be, if there's no friction, it'll just keep going. So now we know why planets just keep going. It's part of the law of inertia. And we also know this, which is a good thing to tell teenage children, and that is that if you're in a moving car, you're sharing the motion with the car. You're moving like the car is. Now, eventually, the car may hit a wall. Now we've got something out of balance. We've got something stronger that's going to stop the car. But if you're not wearing a seatbelt, the wall hasn't hit you yet. There's that space between the windshield and you, and you've always shared the motion of the car. So when the car hits the wall, You keep going until you hit that stronger force, which means you got to wear a seatbelt. And a seatbelt will stop you when the car stops. Or you'll naturally keep going, but the seatbelt's going to hold you in. Now we know why we need to wear a seatbelt. The law of inertia tells us this. And the law of inertia also tells us that if you want to escape Earth's gravity, you just got to have enough force to get the rocket up to a certain point. Now, once you're there, Aristotle will say, you've got to keep pushing the rocket. You've got to keep pushing the rocket. No, you don't. Once you escape Earth's gravity, rocket's going to keep going in the direction you want it to go in. Now we can go to other worlds. And now we also know, by the way, speaking about sharing the motion of the car, that we were wrong to be worried about the old insight that the Earth can't be rotating, because if it were rotating, we would feel it and we'd all be catapulted off the Earth. The Earth is going around at 1,000 miles an hour. It is orbiting the Sun at 67,000 miles an hour. Why don't we feel it? Well, now we know why we don't feel it. Just as we share the motion of the car, we share the motion of the Earth. And when you're in a plane moving at very high speeds, as long as the plane is moving at a fairly constant rate, and as long as it's a smooth flight, like no flight I've ever taken, then you don't feel the moving plane. Well, you know the plane's moving, but you don't feel it. But you will feel it if the plane speeds up, and you will feel it if the plane hits something big. And we don't feel the Earth moving, just as you don't really feel the plane moving. We would feel the Earth moving, however, if the Earth suddenly went 2,000 miles an hour. We feel that, but we don't feel it going around. We feel the change, but we don't feel it going around 1,000 miles an hour. So he had now done everything possible to prove that we're going around the Sun and that we rotate every day. Saw the phases of Venus in the telescope and drew the right conclusion, and now he had demonstrated by the laws of physics, the brand new laws of physics, why it is that we don't feel the moving Earth and how, in fact, things move. And I would suggest that in thinking about nature this way, experimenting and trying really to understand what's happened, we are confronted with wonders far more astonishing than anything the Greeks could have conceived in imagining Cynthia coming down and laying with an Endymion. Wonders are far greater and more spectacularly surprising than the idea of a rabbit obstructing the light of the sun. Because think about all the things we were now in a position to learn about the moon. Among other things, we have come to learn that the moon used to be part of the Earth, right? At one time, a great heavenly entity, perhaps the size of Mars, collided with the Earth and threw off many particles that coalesced into the moon. The moon is our close comrade. It used to be part of us. And it used to be very close to us. So 3.9 billion years ago, after the moon had begun to coalesce, after it had been thrown off of the Earth, it was so close to us that if you looked up in the night sky, it looked 20 times bigger than it does now. So long ago, when the Earth had its first primitive oceans, the moon was exerting such a pull on the oceans that the tide was much higher than it is now and a lot lower than it is now. And in that mixing, salt, non-salt, salt, non-salt, all those tides going like that, a very strong force, may, according to some scientists, have provided the series of chemical reactions that might have first given us life. And maybe life originated in hydrothermal belts in the middle of the lower oceans, but maybe that's how life came, with the strong tides given to us by our close comrade, our close friend, the moon. And that, to me, is more wondrous and more astonishingly strange and beautiful than any myth or any supernatural story that Giordano Bruno might have learned when he was very young. And that's what science gives us. And science also gives us, according to Galileo's laws, especially Newton's laws, who refined Galileo, the possibility of space travel. And that is the spacecraft named after Galileo, which in 2003, after mapping out the moons of Jupiter in tribute to Galileo and learning a lot about the atmosphere of Jupiter, was finally allowed to crash into Jupiter. And so the man who first saw the moons of Jupiter is now immortalized forever as part of the strange environment of the planet that he was so fascinated with. That's the Galileo spacecraft. And that, this little thing here is a crater. It's about 16 or 17 miles across. That's the Giordano Bruno crater, named after Bruno, who first began to at least write about and talk about an infinite universe and a law of conservation of mass and energy so vital to modern physics. So we have immortalized him this way. Look at the rays coming out, the rays of Giordano Bruno's crater. And among other things, we did go to the moon, and we saw the moon, we measured the moon, we took samples from the moon, and we left our footprints behind. And that footprint there, among other things on the moon, because there's no wind on the moon, may well last a million years. And if we disappear from this planet, if everything we've built changes into different atoms, different forms, so that it's very difficult, perhaps, to know what people were, if all the books shifted into different kinds of atoms, dust, and all our computer records went away to whatever other planet we decide to go live on eventually, and there was almost nothing left behind here, so that another civilization would come and not know what to make of it, that civilization could go to the moon, and they could see what a human being was, a footprint from a human being. And so we should pay tribute not just to the martyred Giordano Bruno, but also to the experimental mind of Galileo, who shows us forward to what I think is the wonderland of physics and genuine science. So, that's all for now. Yeah, go ahead.
He was in prison. How did his ideas surface? I mean, if he was, I mean, it certainly carried on, and you're talking about it now. How did that, how was that possible?
Oh,
did they destroy, they couldn't have destroyed his thinking?
Well, if I remember right, he had written this book when he was teaching at Pisa called De Motu, which is his original early findings about the laws of motion. And then what he did was he added to that, and it was put in manuscript form, and it was eventually published in Northern Europe. And not long after that, in Southern Europe, but I don't know when. Does anybody know when it was actually published in Italy? But his ideas were published shortly before he died in other parts of Europe, not subject to the Inquisition.
The things he discovered when he was in prison?
Well, he wasn't really in prison, remember, he's house arrest.
Oh,
so,
house
yeah. So he had visitors. John Milton went to see him, and Thomas Hobbes, the great philosopher, went to see him. He had many visitors. There were plenty of opportunities to get ideas out and get manuscripts out. But I thought if you want to, this might be a good time to stretch. And probably if there's some great victuals out there, I've been looking at them earlier. So have some of those and some coffee. And then. The Galileo experts among you can help me answer any questions that you might have. So please get something to eat. Thank you.